Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. Finance Minister P. Chidambaram is a man who is used to bouquets and brickbats. His 8th budget, however, has evoked a mixed response. Everyone had agreed in the days before he presented the budget that he does not have a very enviable task on hand. He had many challenges and some felt he had many opportunities too. Several areas of the economy have been a cause for concern. Being the last full-fledged budget before the term of the UPA 2 ends, he did have a challenging job to balance the need for restoring the health of the economy and serving the cause of his party with the forthcoming elections in mind. How far has he been able to do this balancing act? Has he been able to put the economy back on track? What were the challenges he faced and how has he tackled them? And how is he been able to utilize the opportunities? We will discuss all this today with a special panel of guests. I have with me Mr. Prem Shankar Jha, a veteran columnist and an economic analyst, Dr. Jagdish Shettigar, member of the National Executive of the BJP and an economist in his own right, Harsh Mander, social activist and former member of the National Advisory Council, Sompal Shastri, former Union Minister for Agriculture. Welcome to all of you. First, let me come to Mr. Prem Shankar Jha. Mr. Jha, there was a challenge, a huge challenge before the finance minister. Do you think he has been able to, come out of it and accept those challenges and been able to make a mark?
The challenge he has, for the first time I've heard a finance minister absolutely honestly tell you what the challenge is and how serious it is.
His candor was quite a...
Yeah, but he, given that, there are two sets of things that have to be done.
Right.
One is in the realm of fiscal policy and fiscal institutions. The other is in the realm of monetary policy.
Right.
In the realm of fiscal and policy and institutions, he has done everything that needed to be done and more. I think it's a remarkable budget. It's an extraordinarily honest budget.
Yes.
It's a budget that does not talk down to people. It's a budget that does not assume you're a fool and you can be led by the nose by your government or by some economist or the other who writes an economic survey. The economic survey was an extraordinarily, searingly honest document.
Right.
I'm very glad that this kind of a budget has come. He has done precisely what is required. He's given the right signals and right incentives for a rise in investment and a kickstart in investment, in fact. And at the same time, what he has done is he has very definitely shown, I'm not going to hand out any tax sops. But don't worry, the super rich will pay. So don't think that they're going to get away free. You know, I'm not giving you the lower middle, the middle class, the struggling middle class tax sop, but I'm going to take some money from the super rich.
He has given some vicarious satisfaction to the middle class.
No, it's a social message of equity, which is very important. That's one. The other is that he has empowered more institutions. They've given them the money for investment in infrastructure. Investment, however, will only take place if there is demand and if the cost of borrowing is low.
Right.
And for infrastructure in particular, the present cost of borrowing is absolutely prohibitive.
Right.
So it's got to be brought down, and that is the job of the Reserve Bank.
Reserve Bank. And how will he be able to convince the Reserve Bank that that the reserve interest rates has to come down?
You want my honest opinion?
Yes.
If the Reserve Bank governor does not bring down interest rates after this, he should be replaced.
Okay.
End of story. Let me tell you something else.
Yes.
Mahathir Mohamad did something similar. He didn't replace it. He replaced only his finance minister and sent him to jail. But the point is, he didn't interfere with the Reserve Bank and so on, but the Reserve Bank and things did what he said. He closed off his markets. He did everything that the IMF said you cannot or should not do. He brought Malaysia out of the 1997 Asian economic crisis within 1 year, whereas all the countries that listened to the IMF were still in trouble 5 years later. You have to have that courage.
Dr. Shettigar? Has Mr. Chidambaram shown courage? Mr. Prem Shankar Jha feels that he has done all the right things as far as fiscal policy initiatives need to be done.
I think he tried to be responsible finance minister, but without any success. As far as the diagnosing of the problem is concerned, I do appreciate the fact that he has been able to pinpoint the problem.
And he has been frank.
And he has, I mean, unlike the last couple of budget, so definitely Chidambaram has indicated that he is aware of the problem and also the solution required to tackle those problems. But when it comes to the specific measures, it is only, I mean, he has tried to create a bubble. In fact, the budget he has presented as the UF government's finance minister, it was described as the dream budget, and it remained as a dream. But this time, I think he tried to create a bubble which is going to burst. It's not just because I'm in the opposition or associate in the opposition, and that is why I'm criticizing. Look at the one of the problem, I mean, identified with the in the economic survey as well as the budget is the slowdown in the industrial sector.
Manufacturing sector.
Yes. The reason also they identified, that is a fall in the investment.
Right.
But this problem should have been addressed properly. Now, why there has been fall in the investment? It is not that there is a shortage of the fund. In fact, the investors, our industrialists are sitting with a surplus fund of more than 9 Mr. lakh crores.
Dr. Shettigar,
why they are not investing?
No, Dr. Shettigar, we will come to the investment issue a little later.
We'll
come to the investment is a very a separate issue. We'll take it up. Let me go to Mr. Sompal Shastri. Mr. Shastri,
please.
We have heard the two economists talking about the fiscal policy and things like that. I want to come straight to your subject. One of the major things which he has, which the economic survey also pointed out about the agriculture, the need for, the growth in agriculture, you think enough has been done to give an impetus to that kind of growth in agriculture sector?
Not at all, because the basic difficulty with the agriculture sector has been the low investment in the agriculture sector, which has been kept stuck to 1.3% of GDP for the last 40 years.
Right.
And there is hardly anything visible in the current budget which seeks to change this scenario. A sector which provides livelihood to 62% of population, provides 56% employment in the economy, and also is responsible for contributing about 14% plus to the GDP, is getting 1.3%, and which interestingly includes private investment. So far as public investment is concerned, it is a very meager 0.3%, and there is hardly anything visible in this to show a departure from the past practice. So I don't see any resolve whatsoever to give a fillip to the agriculture sector at all.
But do you think that the growth rate in agriculture, which was lying below 3%, now he's talking of a 3.6% growth in agriculture sector? Isn't that a positive trend at least? And one of the major things which he has talked about is the agriculture credit and giving credit at 4%. Don't you see these as positives?
You see, agriculture credit is a very misleading figure. It seeks to raise it from 5.75 lakhs projected for the current year
5.75 lakh crore
to about 7 lakh crores.
Yes.
In the next year.
Right.
But the issue here is that the CD ratio of all the branches of the banks operating in India in rural areas continues to be stuck at 30%, which means that the savings put by the rural people in the banks, only 30% are lent back to the people, 70% is siphoned off for the development of other sectors. So where is the favor to agriculture? The banks are acting as plundering agents of rural capital to siphon it off to the other sectors. So it is a very misleading thing. And how come that the credit given by the banks forms part of the budget? It is not reflected in the budget at all. This is completely inappropriate, and nobody raises the issue on this count that it is not legitimate to count the bank credit in the budget. There is no budgetary support. Banks are lending to other sectors also. That is not being shown in the budget. Why it is being included in the budget speech? Nobody questions the propriety of this statement of the finance minister ever.
Okay. Okay, the point taken, Mr. Shastri. But, there is also the other issue of, the subsidies and things like that as far as agriculture is concerned. But
you see, subsidy again is misplaced. 60% of fertilizer subsidies pocketed by the companies. They don't reach the farmer.
Mr. Sompal, we will talk of subsidies a little later. I wanted to bring in Harsh Mander in on this. Mr. Harsh Mander, you know, we are talking of agriculture, agricultural subsidies and things like that. You have been a member of the NAC. You think that this budget caters to the social sector. You know, I want you to focus on the social sector issues. You think there has been many of your colleagues have been through the day expressing some disappointment about the kind of allocations for the social sector?
No, overall, you know, we're talking about a crisis in the economy,
right,
which this budget is trying to address.
Right.
My question is, let us frame the nature of the crisis more clearly.
Right.
Is the crisis merely that we have a slowdown in economic growth, or that even the period of high economic growth was also a period of almost jobless growth?
Absolutely.
So you're seeing very high, even the periods of high economic growth combined with growing unemployment and poverty and very high levels of hunger. I feel that the response, if you recognize that to be the nature of the crisis, then agriculture, for instance, which Mr. Sompal was talking about very correctly, that needed far greater attention. The small and medium manufacturing sector needed to be supported a great deal more. And I think that's there's a disappointment there. And in the social sector, you're seeing small increases. You have a 10,000 crore provision for the food bill. The imagination of the food bill was much larger.
Right.
Many people, I've been hearing commentaries through the day where people have described the food bill primarily as an agency of subsidy. I think one needs to look at the food bill as an investment in people, and if people are invested in, that can be a different kind of engine for economic growth. If you have every second child malnourished, every second young adult who is forming our demographic dividend is likely to be less physically, mentally less developed. So I think that the investments in the social sector have been barely enough to cover inflation and so on. So there's no big picture in terms of addressing that part of our crisis, which is of jobless growth and of high levels of poverty and hunger.
Okay, Mr. Harsh Mander, the fact is that the finance minister, while addressing a press conference later in the evening today, made it very clear that 10,000 crores is just the present allocation, and he made it very clear that if the bill is passed and if there is a requirement for more funds, he is willing to open up his purse on that. Let us see what will happen.
That's encouraging, Mr. Jha,
on these two issues of agriculture, what Mr. Sompal says and what Mr. Harsh Mander says, and generating jobs, does this budget have any such features which can be hopeful to the people as far as generation of jobs are concerned?
If you look at the budget as a top-down exercise where I, the government, if I don't give money, then nothing will happen, then of course it just becomes, you can say, everything has been increased but not by enough. But the question is, does anyone think of whether the money gets to the intended beneficiaries? There's so much evidence, including what people like Rajiv Gandhi, Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi himself said, that 80% at least does not get to them. You take the food, the present, BPL thing. About half the food only gets to the people.
Direct benefit transfer one year.
But you're still talking top down. Right. Don't you understand? What you've got to do is enable the people to stand on their feet, empower them, Now, for example, in health, the way you empower a person is by making him contribute to his health. Once he's contributing, let's say, like the Arjun Sengupta Committee had suggested for unemployment insurance for the unorganized sector, he said, once you're contributing, you're buying a 50 rupee coupon or 1 rupee a day, as he said, then you say, I've got a right. If I fall ill, I'm going to go and I'm going to demand my rights. But there's so much evidence that all top-down social security benefits do not reach the people, that I find this kind of sort of talking just out of date. That's all I can say.
Talking out of date.
It's also extremely wasteful.
We are now joined in by three more guests actually, Mr. Nilotpal, Basu, CPIM, Central Committee member, and J.D. Seelam, Congress MP, and Mr. R.V. Kanoria, former president of FICCI. Let me get J.D. Seelam in on this. Seelam, you know, the budget, it's not been hailed as a dream budget or anything. It's got mixed reactions. Now you have heard some of my guests here. Mr. Prem Shankar Jha's views are completely different from what Harsh Mander or even Sompal Shastri says. He says that this budget, it's a top-down thing. You're going on doling out. That's what he meant.
The critics are accusing the government of not doling out enough.
Critics are doling. So that means that you think that he has doled enough.
I think that the doling Raj must end.
Doling
we are
Raj
in the
must
trouble
end.
We are in today because of the dole Raj.
Doling Raj must end. Seelam, I want you to react to this, and then after that I'll go to Nilotpal Basu also.
Yeah, good evening all of you.
Yes.
I think, it's an exercise under very, very difficult circumstances. He said what are the challenges. He has mentioned the low rate of investment, low rate of savings,
low GDP CD growth rate,
and your fiscal deficit, and I mean these are all, and also the high imports,
yes,
oil imports, and then keeping those constraints in view, he has not done a dream budget, but it's a practical, ground realities. As regards the top down, we have been asking for a bottom up approach, but the 16.425 lakh crores are not being spent by the central government. They are spent by different state governments. He has appealed to all the stakeholders to exercise, the very caution and prudence, and also expect a good governance. I think, expecting a union finance minister to address all the issues, it's too much of expectation at
too
this
much
point.
Of expectation.
Yes, there are certain constraints,
okay,
both internal and external. External okay. constraints also.
Yeah, yeah, we'll
I
come to that.
I think we have to take a holistic view.
No, we'll come.
Rather than picking up holes.
Okay.
And he did not neglect any part of the major social development indicators. The health, the education, the skill development, raising the income levels of the youth. I think a lot of expectations are there. We have to be practical. I think, yes, it's not perfect. It can't be perfect because we need to understand our own situation. We need to understand the external environment. And within the constraints, he has done the best. That's what I feel.
Okay, Nilotpal.
Yes, bottom-up approach is required. Capacity building at the ground level is very important.
Okay,
I'll
come back to you, Seelam. Nilotpal, Mr. Prem Shankar Jha says that this doling out approach needs to be ended and create permanent opportunities instead of giving this kind of doles to people. Empower people.
Where is the dole? There is a sharp cut in the subsidy. In food subsidy, actually he has reduced by 5,000 crores in the allocation which was last year. And then he has given additional 10,000 crores. So net 5,000 crores increase. And if you factor in inflation, actually there is a reduction. In petrol and fuel, there is a 30,000 crores solid cut. Yes, to that extent that he has also cut down state funds to the states by a tune of 30,000 crores, to that extent, yes, process of decentralization also has been affected. But overall, where has he doled out? Our complaint is that he not had to dole out. He had to increase public expenditure. He had to increase subsidies because people are reeling under the threat of inflation. Last Friday, the government put out an answer to a question saying that India is having the highest inflation, food inflation rate in the whole world.
No, he himself expressed concerns about the food inflation. Nilotpal, you stay on. I'll come back to you. Let me get Mr. R.V. Kanoria in on this. Mr. Kanoria, one of the things in the run-up to the budget, the industry was talking about creating proper climate for investments. Do you think the finance minister has created that kind of a climate for the Indian industry to start investing back in India again instead of going out of the country? And second, about the FIIs and FDIs coming into this country?
You know, I think, first of all, let's look at the sincerity of the speech of the finance minister. I think he is very categorically tried to balance, this aspect of fiscal deficit on the one hand, which will result in cutting back of expenditure, and on the other hand, also trying to look at the aspect of growth.
Right.
And in his speech, he has continuously emphasized this concept of growth. And from the financial point of view, I think there are some issues which he has addressed, which will bring some confidence back. But I think many of the things which need to be done are outside the purview of the budget. I mean, when we come to regulatory clearances, that is outside the purview of the budget. When it comes to acquisition of land, that is outside the purview of the budget. I think the atmosphere required for bringing investment into the country is going to get a boost not merely by fiscal concessions or by fiscal incentives, but really through these ground realities which need to be addressed simultaneously with the financial issues. Now, coming to the financial provisions which the finance minister has talked about, one is the reintroduction of investment allowance.
Right.
I believe that the threshold which he has adopted of 100 crores is rather too high, because that is not going to encourage small and medium enterprise to invest. On the other hand, he is also given small and medium enterprise, he says that even if they get out of the eligibility criteria, they will be allowed to carry forward their the advantages which they have for 3 years,
right,
even after they get out of the eligibility framework. So that is a very positive move. And the third point which he has done is that he has made the debt instruments and infrastructure financing. He has seriously addressed that issue. Other than that, I feel that, the increase in tax rates, no concession given on minimum alternative tax is really not going to allow companies to have greater capital formation. So from the investment point of view, I think there are non-budgetary issues which require to be addressed simultaneously with the fiscal provisions, and that is going to be more critical to bringing about this positive atmosphere of actually fueling investments, which is imperative in
the
economy.
Professor Shettigar, he talks about 55 lakh crore investments in the 12th plan period, and 47% of them, as he says, will come from the private sector. Is this optimism or is this realism?
No, it may be optimism, but the merely stating that there is enough space for the infrastructure, that is not sufficient, because again, the continuation of what Mr. Kanoria has said and all, the budget ceased to be a mere what you call the financial statement through under which we used to give the direction to the economy through mere expenditure and the revenue collection.
Right.
Since we adopted the reforms, it has become a total policy statement.
Right.
So that is why, what the government is thinking about the various other aspects, that is required. So that is why in that connection, now you raise the issue of the infrastructure.
Right.
Now what he has done, when he mentions about the 50 lakh crores of the space, But in terms of the concrete measures, he has simply said that I will facilitate what he called the infrastructure bonds to the extent of 50,000 crores.
Yes, and there are other measures also.
Where are the other measures? I mean, there is a lot of infra. I mean, the reforms in the infrastructure is required, whether it is the case of the power or the coal or the petroleum, all these are pending. So without the introducing the reforms in the infrastructure sector, I don't think that the private investment will flow in. Now again, coming to the attracting the investment, I think had he implemented a policy pending with the government, that is, there was a proposal to introduce the time-bound clearance to the industrial proposal. Had he implemented, in one proposal, he could have tackled the many problems like attracting investment, both domestic as well as the foreign.
This cabinet committee on investment, is that is what it's supposed to do, act as a single window agency.
What did he say? He said that I will constitute a cabinet committee to study the problems faced by the industry. Now, does the cabinet committee is required to study the problems being faced by the industry? All that he has to do is the comply the problems faced by that. I don't think. And the industry has been pointing out that the governance deficit, I'm not talking about the policies, new policy initiative, the governance deficit. And recently, the Prime Minister himself has what he called the advice, the Environment Minister. Within the what he called the existing policy, government is not acting. Why are, I mean, holding up the project proposal? The environment is the only one issue. You have got the policy. Either you accept it or the reject it. What do you want to keep
Mr.
it?
Mr. Jha, you know, this debate has been going on for some time. Prime Minister has addressed this issue. Even today in his interview, he addressed this issue. He says that the Cabinet Committee on Investment will look into these things. But the point which Professor Shettigar is talking about, environment clearances and things like that, this has been a sticky problem.
Actually, both the environment clearance and the land are part of the same issue.
Yes.
Which, you know, sometimes
what Mr. Kanoria spoke about.
What we do not have in India today, it's not that there's no absolute land, but that land is all settled on. Therefore, to get any land for industry, you've got to throw somebody out of his livelihood.
This land acquisition.
Allow me to finish, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
That problem has not been solved. You've got to make the people who live off the land your partners in this development.
Right.
And you've got to ask them how to do that development in a way that minimizes the destruction of the environment.
Right.
And because they're still stakeholders in the land, they will help you in both designing that and also in immediately repairing the damage.
Right.
Now, this is the whole question of the top down. Why is this happening? It's happening because land is the most valuable source of corrupt money for the political system today. It's the same in China. China's legitimacy of the Communist Party is being destroyed by the issue of land.
Right.
The legitimacy of the entire Indian democratic system is being destroyed on the issue of land. You've got 100 million tons of coal that you're importing today, and we have the fourth largest coal reserves in the world.
Okay.
And what is this?
Absolutely. I want both Mr. Sompal Shastri and Harsh Mander also to address this issue. Mr. Sompal Shastri first. You know, in this whole business of land acquisition and things like that, where, you know, how does it affect the agriculture? Do you think that, you know, this shift from agriculture to industry or, you know, other infrastructure projects is necessary? And, you know, already people talk that we are too much dependent on agriculture.
Now you see, we are not too dependent, and we must remain too dependent on agriculture, because it is a question of ensuring the food security and sovereignty of the nation. And without being dependent on agriculture, our nation cannot seek to remain self-reliant and even sovereign. So it is a misplaced argument to say that we are too dependent on agriculture. But then the dependency ratio of population on agriculture is definitely a worrying question.
Right.
The pattern of development that we are trying to adopt and copying the Western model, we try to say that the contribution of agriculture to GDP is reducing, and as if this is a conclusive sign of modernization of economy, but a commensurate shift of population from agriculture to other professions, which has been taking place in case of the developed countries, has not happened in India. That is the issue. And this is because there has been no equitable development of the rural areas in terms of connectivity, in terms of provision of energy, in terms of provision of basic amenities like education, health, and security, and other things, and the other infrastructure. Therefore, non-agricultural job generation in the rural areas has not taken place, and therefore the burden on land is increasing. That is the issue which has not been addressed.
Okay,
coming back to the value of land, I'm sorry to state that all the governments, including the federal government, the central government, have become real estate dealers, whether it is allotting the mines or allotting the road projects or the port projects or the airport projects or the housing, urbanization, SEZ, EEZ, industrial estates. Governments have become part and parcel of a nexus with the real estate dealers, and they have been raising the price unnecessarily, and then providing a sop to the housing sector on the loan side is a very misplaced concept, because the government has itself been part and parcel of conspiracy of raising the price of the lands, which has become prohibitive cost for providing housing to a country where housing is a big problem.
Mr.
So
Sompal,
these are all related issues. These have not been addressed.
Okay, Mr. Sompal, please stay on. Mr. Harsh Mander, I want you to also to address this issue, because the industry says that, you know, clearances doesn't happen, environmental clearance doesn't happen. But as Mr. Prem Shankar Jha rightly pointed out, the problem is elsewhere. Do you agree with that?
No, you know, I mean, Mr. Jha has also said many things, and with all due respect, I believe that, you know, we really need to question the current common sense that a country can develop only with economic growth which is fostered by facilitating big private industry.
Right.
You know, we need to look at what has happened the last 20, 25 years in terms of employment, in terms of how the bottom 5-6 deciles of the population have fared. You know, he talked about giving free gifts. Just let us look at what every budget, you know, cumulatively over the last several years, we've given something like 30 lakh crores as tax holiday to big industry. When you look at the tax to direct to indirect tax ratios, we substantially, most of our revenue is coming in from indirect taxes. So it is not the poor who are being given freebies. Let us recognize who's being given freebies in today's environment. And when we talk about the duty of the state to provision public goods like healthcare, education, food, to its population, it's not something that's a dole that is being given out. It's investing in the people who are going to be fueling this growth. And one last thing I'd like to say is that, you know, we keep I remember when NREJ was happening, the discussion was the same. There was a talk about freebies, etc. Now most industry is willing to recognize that NREJ, with all its difficulties, has made a great difference in putting more money into people's hands.
Right.
It has, in fact, spurred growth. So can we have a new imagination of growth which is centered around
people,
investing in our people, in ensuring them opportunities to invest, to have more money in their hands, to have more jobs, and to strengthen small industry. When you're talking about private industry, what about street vendors? What about small producers?
Yes, yes.
What about the craft industry? So I think let us by all means spur growth, but let us spur growth which includes in that whole process the smallest producer.
Okay.
And not just go
Mr.
on
Harsh.
With the old idea that it is only through private investment that we are going to go ahead.
Mr. Harsh Mander, the outlay for the flagship program, some of the major flagship programs, Chidambaram talks about, you know, providing for it. But it's very interesting. Many people are now talking about how it has stagnated. He has not raised actually the allocations for some of the flagship programs. Yes. Like I want to bring in the Congress MP JD Seelam in on this. Seelam, you think that, you know, this approach of the finance minister is going to be in any way helpful to the party in election year? He has not increased the allocations for the flagship programs, the social sector flagship programs.
No, I think he made increased allocations, but as I tell you, if you start using it, there will not be any problem for these flagship programs, I can assure you. I think the Honorable Finance Minister also mentioned, no, we can provide as you go on spending. In fact, it's unfortunate that some of these flagship programs, ministries have not spent money in the last budget, provisions of the last budget. I think it depends on the different ministries. They should try to reach out to the state governments and then go down to the field level where the benefits of these, the provisions made in the budget are spent. Definitely, we will pressurize them to release more funds if it is required. That's not going to be a problem.
Okay. Nilotpal, coming to you, that's not going to be a problem. You people have been objecting to it. One more interesting thing in this budget is Chidambaram has said that petroleum subsidies, if you look at the allocation to the Petroleum and Oil Ministry, over 27,000 crores has been reduced. So you think that, do you think his confidence is okay, is not misplaced when he says that he can reduce the petroleum bill by about 27,000 crores? And how is he going to do it? I want both Prem Shankar Jha and Jagdish Shettigar also to... Before that, you, Nilotpal.
First point is, Mr. Seelam, he must understand that the way the finance minister has achieved bringing down fiscal deficit to 5.2% precisely gives us the clue that there is a problem, and very much the problem is there, because he has tweaked with the figures of allocation. And there's a sharp drop in almost all public expenditures, including social sector, where revised estimates are far less than the public, initial budgetary allocation.
Nilotpal, 1 minute. The argument is that if he had not done that, he wouldn't have been able to keep the fiscal deficit at 5.2.
No. Just hang on.
Yes.
That is why I am saying that sharply, after public consumption being at the level of 8% for 3 consecutive years, it has sharply come down to 4%, which means there is a contraction in public expenditure, and that reduction in public expenditure he has effected, that he has given primacy to reduce the level of fiscal deficit. And now he wants to bring it further down to 4.8%.
Right.
So that will be the precise area of target where he will slash to achieve his dream figures. So therefore, instead of hold on the release, there will be a tightening of the fist, actually.
Tightening and of the fist.
About the petrol subsidy,
yes.
I question the whole reference of subsidy to what is being given in the petroleum sector. Because the tax that is being collected by the government from the petroleum sector is 2.5 times than the so-called subsidy. So something is priced at 100 rupees, you increase the tax by 50 rupees, and then you sell it at 25 rupees and say, I have given 25 rupees subsidy.
Nilotpal,
all the petroleum companies, all the oil companies, they are making profit.
The government ought to do, if the international
crude prices are going up, they must reduce the taxes on oil products.
Nilotpal, please, you'll get a chance again.
They cannot do that.
Nilotpal, because
they are giving, in this kind of a gloomy situation, 40,000 extra 40,000 crores of extra.
Okay, Mr. Jha, two things, you know, what both of them are talking about. You know, reducing the, he has done a decent job in containing the fiscal deficit, right? And he's talking about a 4.8% fiscal deficit, and he said it in the press conference, that will be the line drawn and it will not go above that.
Let me say one thing about fiscal deficit reduction. There are two ways of doing it. One is by just cutting expenditure. But when you cut expenditure, that means that that purchasing power goes down. Therefore, the tax revenues also slow down in growth because less is sold, and more companies start losing money. So the better way to reduce fiscal deficit is through growth.
Right.
If you look historically at whether at the U.S. in the 1990s or India in the 90s and the first half of the 2000s, the fiscal deficit came down precisely because we had rapid growth.
Right.
And the same was true of U.S. And therefore, today, you can only do that if you lower the interest rates. Free higher purchase, free investment, lower the cost of borrowing, give a kick to investment. That will not happen unless there is a very strong demand. And the whole point here is that if you do not reduce the fiscal deficit simultaneously, then you will not be able to contain the kind of inflationary pressures that will emerge from it. If you want to have minimize inflationary pressures, at the same time have a much bigger jump in investment and consumption, you must cut down fiscal deficits. It's a transfer of money from non-productive to productive uses.
He has shown some optimism. He's very confident. It seems that he'll be able to reduce it to 4.8%.
Let me tell you, some data that are being thrown around is just wrong. First and foremost, during the period of high growth before 2008, the rate of growth of employment in the non-agricultural unorganized sector
unorganized
was 5.7% per year.
Unorganized sector, that is a...
5.7%.
Right, but Mr. Jha,
hold a moment.
There is a study by the Institute of Applied Manpower Research, a wing of the Planning Commission, which says that between 2005 and 10 there was jobless growth in the economy.
Not between 2005 and 2010.
No, 2005 and 10. That is the figure of the
report submitted in the Planning
Commission.
But
anyway,
I would look at the way that the report has been.
No, but the argument is that in the organized sector there has been no growth.
You see, what you had is a rise and then a sharp drop. The sharp drop is not being, studied. You're not doing
anyway,
sample surveys.
I want Professor Shettigar on the petroleum business. He says 27,000 crores. He's very confident of bringing down the oil bill. You think his confidence is real? Is valid?
No, if the confidence...
How is he going to do that?
If the confidence...
What does it mean?
Confidence is based on certain measures, then I would have been very happy. Now, as far as the price trend in the international market is concerned, that depends on the OPEC's attitude. It is beyond the control of Mr. Chidambaram. But what he could have done is the two things. One, by attracting the foreign investment, the rupee could have been strengthened. So, thereby the contribution of the what he called the weakening rupee in terms of what he called the raising the price of the
oil
that
bill.
Could have been prevented. He could have brought down the bill. And the second, the tax on that. That is, if the customs duty is made, instead of the ad valorem basis, it has been made on the specific basis as recommended by the Tax Reforms Committee constituted by Mr. Chidambaram himself during the 2004-05, the term. And also it is the practice in certain countries like the U.S.
Right.
That these two measures could have brought down the import bill, which
but
he has not
know.
Done.
No, no, he says that he will bring it down by 27,000. I want to get Mr.
Yes,
Kanoria.
That is what I'm telling
Mr.
you.
Kanoria,
what basis?
Mr. Kanoria, what do you think is the confidence of the finance minister when he says that the petroleum, when 27,000, nearly 27,000 crores, he'll be able to reduce for the oil bill or the petroleum bill. Where does the confidence come from?
No, I think the finance minister must be having some calculation on that. I think the petroleum bill is something which is not going to be very easy to control.
Right.
And I think we should not debate too much on this issue. I think what we really need to understand is that the economy needs growth. And I think Mr. Jha has mentioned very clearly that, you know, the model of growth needs to be followed if we really want to reduce the fiscal deficit. And for that, the confidence needs to come back in the economy.
Right.
I'll also like to borrow from what Mr. Sompal said, and I think it's very important to understand that the agriculture sector, if you really look at it, the per capita incomes in the agriculture sector are actually going down in the country. So the dependence of the number of people on agriculture is not reducing.
Right.
And that's not a good trend. So we have to find some method of increasing agriculture productivity. And that sector needs to go through the same reform process that industry went through so that we can become competitive in agriculture. I mean, this is an area which requires much, much more attention
absolutely.
Than I think has been given even in the budget. I mean, you know, interest subvention, etc. is not the answer. I think research, development, and the introduction of a new green revolution is required in this country if we really want. And secondly, we also want to move away from this entire concept of rice and wheat, and we must go into, you know, more into the products
which
reflect the consumption pattern of today.
Mr. Kanoria, in fact, the finance minister has said exactly the same thing. A second green revolution. He spoke about how the eastern side of the country has been doing well, and the areas where the first green revolution took place. He's talking of, you know, expanding the crops and, you know, different things. Anyway, I want to bring in Harsh Mander in here. Mr. Harsh Mander, do you suspect that when the finance minister talks about reducing the petroleum subsidy or, you know, bringing down the oil bill, is he talking about removing subsidies on, you know, LPG and things like that? Where do you think, or what is your guess on this?
See, I mean, it would be. I don't think it's appropriate to speculate on what other subsidies that hit the poor more, whether they'll go down. I think there is always a danger. People are talking about bringing down the deficit through bringing down subsidies. I just wanted to bring in a slightly different question because, you know, the amount. Another way of reducing subsidy is by raising more taxes. And I think we need to have a discussion about whether our tax to GDP ratio, which is much lower than in many other countries,
right,
our direct to indirect taxes, our indirect taxes are much higher than direct taxes. The integrity with which we are raising our taxes, to say that they're just 43,000 people who have an income, annual income more than 1 crore, is laughable. When we just look at expenditures around, you know, how
I think,
conspicuous
no,
consumption.
Mr.
We look at tax haven. So I think that we need to look
Mr.
at.
I think you have made an important point there. Before when the budget, during the days in the run up to the budget, there was a lot of discussion about widening the tax base. Mr. Prem Shankarja, has he done enough to widen the tax base? Just, you know, 42,800 people, 1 crore and above, 10% surcharge. But what about steps being taken to widen tax base? You See, think there is any measures?
I think that was not the purpose of what he's done. The purpose was precisely in order to start a process of thinking that the benefits of development cannot be appropriated without any kind of return to society by the very rich. Mm. I think this is only the beginning.
Yes.
I think there should be more of this, but it should be in a way that doesn't drive people into the black market and then kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. There's already enough of a black market. In fact, that's precisely the point that Mr. Mander is making. That I think is a very important thing. Secondly, there are many better ways of raising taxes. I mean, the service tax, for example, right, is a very important thing.
Service tax has grown phenomenally in the last few years.
For the first time, state governments are actually, you can see they're making roads, right, they're building things, infrastructure. State governments are investing in infrastructure, which never happened before.
Yes.
And we don't see it because it doesn't come in the central budget.
Okay. Nilotpal, you know, widening the tax base has been one of the issues which has been discussed. You think the finance minister has done enough to increase the tax base?
I think, Girish, in a situation where you have a slowdown, where the GDP rate is coming down, where unemployment is growing, there, in spite of everything, 50 top corporate houses, they managed to increase their corporate profits by 12.5%. So it is very, very clear that when growth happens, they get disproportionately larger benefit of that. When the economy goes down, they manage to stick their neck out of the water. So, on the same principles, it is the very same sections who should have been the target of the finance minister to raise resources, which is a meaningful way of facilitating growth and investing in infrastructure and increase in the social sector investment. But he has not chosen the way. He has given an additional 40,000 crores of tax waiver. You see, today our fiscal deficit is precisely 5,20,000 crores. And 5,73,000 crores is the tax waiver that he has announced in the budget. So you can make out who is responsible for the fiscal deficit and who has to pay more to come out of this mess.
Nilotpal, Mr. let me get Mr. Kanoria in on this. Mr. Kanoria, this charge of the of certain people like Nilotpal, Basu, that you know even that 10% surcharge which has been charged on people who have more than a crore of rupees, but they have been given through the back door more benefits. The tax foregone has gone up to 5,70,000 crores.
I don't want to get into this debate because I don't for 1 minute believe that you know profit should not be made by the corporate sector. If there are no profits, then there is no way that the economy can be driven. So, I know we have to decide on the model which we want for development. Either it can be a model which is based on the model of industrial growth or it is based on distributing income. I believe that if we are just going to distribute income, we are only going to diffuse poverty. We are not going to create wealth. So, growth and creation of wealth goes concomitant with profitability. And I don't buy this argument that if corporate profits go up by 12.5%, then it's, you know, I mean, if they go up by 12.5%, it's because of economic activity. I mean, it is nothing related to margins there. I think if you look at the corporate margins today, the margin of profitability has declined substantially because we are becoming more and more uncompetitive.
The scale has gone up.
I think that problem needs to be addressed much more seriously.
Can I respond, Girish?
We need to address the problem of uncompetitiveness. I mean, that's
just one line.
The user pay concept has to come.
There is a 9:1.
Nilotpal.
Proportion.
Nilotpal, quickly, very quickly.
Profit growth as against labor. In our GDP.
Okay, Seelam.
Over the last 20 years.
Okay, Seelam.
Yeah, I think what model is appropriate? I think we have already been, you know, implementing, but the main focus should be reducing the socio-economic, you know, disparities. You know, we need to reduce those disparities by increasing the capacity building among the, you know, marginalized sections. That also should be part of the corporate thinking. The corporate, we are not saying you don't make money, but you don't make money at the cost of the poor.
Absolutely.
That's the point.
Absolutely.
So I think that should be the central, and then we have to take a balanced view.
Populism.
This is what I said.
Okay, Seelam, the guests in the studio, Mr. Prem Shankar at least thinks that this is pure populism. But anyway, this
not
conflict.
Most of what I've heard today.
This conflict between two different ideas is something which will continue in this country for quite some time to come. There is no agreement on what kind of a system we need to have. But anyway, today's budget of Mr. Chidambaram has created a lot of discussions and debates on this. And I'm sure in the coming days also there will be much more discussions as the budget is read further and the small print is seen. So we will keep watching and we'll continue to discuss this in the coming days also. Thanks to all my guests, Nilotpal Basu, J.D. Seelam, Sompal Shastri, Sompal Shastri, Harsh Manda, Prem Shankar Jha, Dr. Jagdish Shettigar and R.V. Kanoria. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on the big picture, same time tomorrow.